First of all, thank you everyone for showing up. I'm absolutely honored that you guys all showed up. So as educators and educated, we have this opportunity to really meet with people throughout our entire lives, people who really make these meaningful connections and lasting impressions on us. And I know that you guys have all had that experience. I myself have as well. In 2011, my last year of undergraduate studies at the City College of New York, I met Mikhal Dekel. She was an absolutely amazing professor, and I'm just absolutely privileged that I'm able to share her with my current community. So thank you guys so much for showing up. And please give a large welcome to Mikhal Dekel.
So how cool is that, right? That you get to an email from your ex-student to come and give a talk to his current students. This is absolutely wonderful, and thank you so much. Is it Raphael or Mr. Eaton or Mr. Eaton for inviting me? And thank you all for coming, whether it's for extra credit or not. I'm so happy to see you. And I should say, this is the first talk ever that I'm giving to high school or to school children. So all my talks have been to university. And actually, I think the average age in my talks has been like maybe 70, 80. So this is such a pleasure. And you'll have to give me feedback and tell me if it works or not and what I should adjust. 10 years ago, I began to write a book about a man whom I spent every day and night with for the first 18 years of my life and more, but about whom I didn't know very much, my father. I knew that he had been born, so I was born and raised in Israel. I knew that my father was born in Poland in a town called Ostomazowiecka. I knew that he had come to Israel with a group of children called the Tehran Children, that he had come from Poland to what was then British-controlled Palestine before the State of Israel was founded in 1943. I knew he came with a group of children through Tehran, and I knew that these children are called Tehran Children. I did not think of my father, nor did he present himself as a Holocaust survivor. He was just simply an Israeli man, a little depressive, a little quiet, a little enigmatic, a little angry. And we had a fairly tense relationship. That was about it. In 1993, he died from a degenerative brain disease called mad cow disease. I don't know if people know what that is, but it's a kind of brain disease that you get from eating infected cow brain. And we all wondered, where did he eat infected cow brain? We didn't really know. It's a very rare disease. He died very quickly, and I came here, and I became an English professor. I was very far removed from his life and from the story. And then in 2007, another colleague of mine, and I don't know if you studied with Salar Abda, who was a creative writer, who's Iranian, we were in a faculty party, and Salar says to me, "Hey, do you know anything about Holocaust refugees, children who were in Iran during the war?" I'm like, "Well, as a matter of fact, I do." "Why?" It turns out somebody in Iran wrote an article about this, and he wanted to know if it's true or not. And there was a lot of talk then, I mean, as there is now, about Iran being, I mean, Iran and Israel are sort of at war with each other, and there was talk about Iran being complicit in the Holocaust with the Nazis, and somebody wrote a defense of Iran and said, "Hey, we saved Jewish children." And I was like, "Oh, wow, did Iran save my father? I never thought of that." And I didn't really know that my colleague asked me, how did he get to Iran? Who, from Poland? And I had no idea. And that became the beginning of what is now, many years later, this book. So this is a book that took a decade to write, in case you're planning to write a book. I have a son who's 16 and kind of your age, and he says, because the book has become very it's get a lot of reviews and I have a lot of talks, and he says, I want to be famous like you. And I say to him, well, you know, you have to find a way to do it quicker than me, maybe become a rap artist or something. So the book took a long time, and I'll tell you in a minute why it took such a long time. But the book that I ended up writing is actually not just about my father. It's also not just about these Tehran children. So the Tehran children, these kids who are known as Tehran children, were almost 1,000 children, Polish Jewish children, Holocaust survivors who were brought to, as I said, to Israel through Iran. But I ended up writing a book not just about them, but about most Polish Jews who survived the Holocaust. Now, I don't know if you studied the Holocaust or if you know anything about that, but in Poland, before the war, there was the largest Jewish population in Europe. So in Poland, there were roughly 3.5 million Jews in 1939. In 1945, after the Holocaust, 90% of them are killed. So about 350,000 survive. Of these 350,000, 250,000, a quarter million, survive in Central Asia, which means Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, and also in Iran, and in Palestine, and in Lebanon, and in India, many people, and in Syria. So all of these people, in a way, survive outside Europe, mostly in Central Asia and the Middle East. And these people, who are the largest population of Polish Holocaust survivors, have not really been written about very much. They haven't really been thought about as survivors, per se. They didn't receive reparations. They have not been researched, and we don't see, you know, how, like, there are a lot of books, right, about the Holocaust and movies and so on, but we actually haven't seen them represented in these movies. So I ended up writing their book. So a book for all of these people, and it's been very exciting. Now to get, I'm getting tons of emails and Facebook messages from people who are like descendants of these people, and they say, oh my God, my mom was in Uzbekistan, and I thought she was the only one. You know, there are 250,000 people there, but if you don't have a story, you think it's only your story, right? And so the book became that, and at the same time, the book remains a kind of intimate second generation Holocaust, a daughter's memoir of her father. It's really a memoir maybe of a father who was a survivor who has the symptoms of a survivor without the story of a survivor, and I wrote that story. So what I want to do in the next 30 minutes or so is to understand the fate of these roughly 250,000 people that I tell through the story of my father. And perhaps we can start to think about the fate of these people through thinking about these two children. So this is roughly middle of 1939. A boy and a girl. The boy is 12, the girl is 7, and these are their parents behind them. They live in, as I said, in Poland, which is the country in Europe that has the largest Jewish population. They're Jewish. They live in a town where 30% of the town are Jewish and 60% during their parents' time. So it's a very Jewish town. Their family, as I found out, because I did a lot of research about their pre-war life also, is one of the two oldest and wealthiest families in this town. They have lived in this town for 8 generations. Now, this boy, they grow up in this very, very secluded way. They live in a kind of family compound. The girl has never left their home, her hometown. The boy, my father, has left hometown once for a tonsillectomy operation in Warsaw, 60 miles away. So these are these children. 3 years later, obviously this is not them, but this is where they are. They're disembarking in a port town in Iran called Bandar Pahlavi. It's a port town in northern Iran on the Caspian Sea. So these are basically Polish army soldiers, and embedded in them are children, and Christian and Jewish children, and embedded in those children is my father, my aunt, and they actually had a younger cousin with them. So basically, in the summer of 1939, they had a cousin who was summered with them, basically was spending time with her grandparents, who also lived there, and she fled with them. She ended up having the same fate while her parents and her siblings died in Warsaw. So these children are getting off right here. They have been, this is August 1939, 3 years after they began their journey. They are, they suffer from severe malnutrition. They weigh less than they did 3 years earlier. They are 5,000 miles away from home. Now I want you to look at, I have like a pointer, it's not really working. So look at this, this is where they start out. This is Ostrom-Mazowieckie Pole, that's their hometown. They've traveled 1,400 miles to, this is all the way to the north of Russia, okay? And I'll tell you how they got there in a minute. Then they travel all the way through the Soviet Union to the south, to Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan. I know it means nothing to you, but it's like, you know, this, I mean, just look at the distances, just look at the numbers. 1,400 miles, 550, 2,000 miles, 1,200 miles. They now cross this Caspian Sea, now right here. These two kids who never left their hometown, basically. And a lot of this is by walking. It's by walking these distances, and it's really, I don't know if you guys walk very much, but I somehow have a feeling you don't, right? You drive, and but I, you know, when I began this, as I said, my son was 6, 7, I would think like, how do they, you know, I mean, I would be like, so hard to get him to walk from like the middle of the block to the end of the block, and you know, walking 5,000 miles. But this is the reality of this story. So now these children are, oh, and I should say also, and this is very relevant to the things that we think about today about unaccompanied children, migrant children, and they're without parents or any adult supervisors. Okay. A few weeks later, they're taken to the Jewish Home of Tehran. This is really it's a couple of tents and this building back there, and you can see how small some of the children. Some of the children are three. They're toddlers, really. So from toddlers to 17-year-olds, they're collected in this camp, and they're taken. Eventually, they're evacuated to Palestine. I'll tell you how in a minute. But so, how did they get from Poland to Palestine really quickly? In 1939, just a very quick history lesson, I promise. So in 1939, this is Poland. 1939, after Poland gets occupied, first by Nazis and then by the Soviets, and it gets partitioned. Basically, this part becomes controlled by the Germans, this part becomes controlled by the Soviets. My father's family lives somewhere here, and many people, especially Jewish, but also not only Jewish, also Christian, flee the Germans. They know the Germans are coming, they flee from this side to this side. Other people don't flee, they simply live in those towns, they fall under Soviet occupation. So, in fact, in early 1940, 1.5 million of, out of these 3.5 million Jews, 1.5 million live here under Soviet control. Which is, you know, we don't really know because we think about the Holocaust as Germans, Nazis, but they really live under Soviet control. They eventually, this is very hard to see, but what happens is of these people, you don't need to even see this, I just want to show you this. All of these places are places of exile. So all these people who are in the Soviet Union, the Soviet government arrests a number of them, about 500,000, and deports them, exiles them to the Soviet interior. This is what they call Siberia, basically. So they put them basically, and they're arrested for various reasons. Mostly they're arrested because the Soviet Union needs manpower to build railroads and to build factories, and they arrest them and exile them very, very far away. And the way you're arrested, you're put in a train, you're locked up, and you just go. They don't tell you where you're going. You don't have any food. Many people die already there and then. And then after 2 weeks, maybe you're dropped off somewhere. And if you're lucky, there's a house, there's shacks there, and you can work. And they work in sort of minus 50 degrees. Fahrenheit in horrible conditions, these 14-hour days, works cutting lumber and so on. And you can, as you can imagine, these are not people who are farmers. These are people who are urban people, and all of a sudden they're told to cut trees. And this, the Soviets say that 25% of the exiles died. Now these are the people who exiled them say 25%. So we know that it's a conservative number. After 14 months, I won't belabor you with the details, but basically because of certain historical circumstances, the exiles are released from these special settlements. This is a deportation card, and they go south to, so if we go, I'll go back to the map. Sorry.
So basically, this is where the labor camp is for my father. They are released, and they go into what is, it's a kind of second deportation, but it's not an organized deportation. They all flock south to this area, in Central Asia. And this is where, these are basically mostly Muslim lands that are under Soviet control, and this is where most of the Polish, Jewish, and some non-Jewish refugees will stay for the duration of the war. So these are Jewish refugees in Bukhara, which is in Uzbekistan, in 1944, and they're holding a Yiddish paper. And I don't know if people know, does anybody know what Fiddler on the Roof is? It's a play, Fiddler on the Roof. So they actually do Fiddler on the Roof in Uzbek, in Tashkent. So all kinds of interesting things happen from this, you know, when refugees come to a place and interact with the local population. But there is, the conditions are very, very hard. There is a complete famine in Central Asia, and when there's an opportunity for certain amount of children to leave Uzbekistan, to leave the USSR, and be evacuated to Iran, my grandparents decide to send their children. And this is a hard choice, and this is a very, very traumatic moment because, as you can imagine, you know, sometimes you think, even if it's hard conditions, I'm not going to separate from my children. Whatever happens to me will happen to my children. Other people say, maybe we'll die, but we'll save our children. Because the Jewish adults are not allowed to join the evacuation, so basically just the children. I'm going to skip it a little bit and see. Then I'll come back to this. So the children are evacuated to Iran, as I said. Iran is the first country after 3 years that has bread. Iran in 1939 is a neutral country. In other words, doesn't side with allies and it doesn't side with access of the powers. I'll just read you. So one of the most wonderful sources that I had was a travel diary that one of the children wrote on this journey. And I wanted to read you, I'll just read one passage from his travel diary. His name is Emil Landau, he's 14 years old, he was born in Warsaw. This is how it describes arriving in Iran. On the historic day of August 16, 1942, in 40 degrees and some weather, 40 degrees Celsius, right? The first, so it's what? It's like 120 Fahrenheit, something like that. It's very hot. The first group of passengers leaves the tugboat's dock and after a half an hour's sail gets to the small port, Bandar Pahlavi. Difficult to transmit in writing the first impression. Each one feels as if he's born again, has come to a place out of this world. The port's waters are littered with flower beds. The port's waters are littered with colorful boats. The surroundings are mowed lawns and flower beds. Rows of impressive Chevrolets and Studebakers wait for transport. And everything seems good and beautiful. Everything smiles together with the Persians who gaze at us with pity. After we are on shore, everyone hugs everyone. So, you know, you just wouldn't expect that the Holocaust refugees would end up in Iran during the war, but there they are, and people
local people, there are a lot of beautiful stories. The local people don't know anything. They don't know who they are. They're not prepared. They don't tell them, hey, tomorrow these refugees will arrive. They get off these boats and people see them. They look horrible. I mean, they're thin, with a lot of diseases. They have eye diseases. And people see them and they start bringing them candy and bringing them food and so on. So they're very moving stories. Now, the Studebaker, does anybody know what a Studebaker is? The trucks, the kind of trucks, Chevrolets, you know, right? So Chevrolets and Studebakers. And the Studebakers and the Chevrolets, guess where they come from? America, exactly. So America is sending aid to the Allies, to the people who are fighting the Nazis, and a big chunk of this aid comes in the form of military trucks, and it's shipped through Iran. So these Polish children, like my father, actually, and my father's family owned a beer brewery, and they had Chevrolet Studebaker trucks, and here they are, they see these trucks that come from America. It's one of those crazy things. This is a Life magazine ad from 1943. It has Iran in the background, and it says, Studebaker military trucks, like our Yanks, are certainly seeing the world. Maybe I just want to stop here for a second. Maybe talk about the process of working for me of working on the book. So, the book is part history, kind of the stuff that I told you, but it's also part travelogue. So I traveled to Poland twice, to Uzbekistan, to Russia, to those areas where people were exiled. I couldn't travel to Iran because I'm an Israeli citizen. Oh, I mean, I guess I could travel. Maybe I wouldn't necessarily come back to speak here. My colleague who's Iranian researched for me, and I traveled to Israel. So traveling and researching these places is not really easy. I mean, Uzbekistan, especially in 2013, especially was worse. It was a dictatorship, and you couldn't just go and say, hi, I'm a researcher, and please take me to the Secret Service archives, and can you give me, that just wouldn't work. So, in fact, I had to pretend like I'm a regular tourist, and then I had a clandestine research assistant who was helping me, and I'll tell you more about him in a minute. And in other places, too, it was very hard to do this research. In Russia, I mean, Russia obviously is no longer Soviet, but those areas are very, not so easy to research there either. It's not like going to Moscow or St. Petersburg, to the big cities. You go to this little place and you go into the hotel and there are like two dudes sitting there and somebody says, yeah, that's like plainclothes policemen. They're just kind of watching you and you're like the only American there. And then when you go to places, people already know you're there. So it's not dangerous, but so dangerous, but it's a little uncomfortable, and people just don't tell you the truth. You ask them, Uzbekistan especially, I mean, you interview them, and they said, no, everything is great, everything is wonderful, nothing bad ever happened here. As I said, you know, I know I keep making references to my son, but the time my son was obsessed with Star Wars, and I said to him, you know how the Jedi go to a place and it seems too perfect? Everybody says, everything is great, nobody says anything bad, you know it's really bad. And it was very hard to, people only kind of speak to you, they would say, don't record me and so on. So that part is hard, but also understanding what you're finding, right? Because I don't know if you're doing research projects already, but if you're researching something where there's not a lot of information about it, you don't even know what you're researching, you don't even know what you're looking for, you're sort of accumulating information and hoping it'll come together. So it's not just understanding the particulars, it's understanding the framework, the general story, right? I don't know if you ever read, have you read anything about like Art Spiegelman's Mouse or any work about Auschwitz maybe, or memoirs or stuff like that? If you read, let's say if you know that your dad was in concentration camp, God forbid, you know what that means, right? You know what that means. You know what his experience was. If you learn that your dad went through this, you don't even know what it means. So that part took a long time to figure out.
And once I figured it out, I understood a few things, which to me were very interesting. One of them is that when we think about a refugee story, when we think about a refugee story, we think about sort of going from point A to point B. And I almost had a fantasy that my father went from Poland to Palestine. Like almost he was like sort of a fairy tale, like he was almost airlifted, right? But it's not like that. And not only is it not like that, but in this, when you look at this, it's such a long route. Every place of transit is an end point for so many people. And those, so for example, people stayed in Siberia. People were exiled to these places, these really, really desolate places. Then they were released, but they said, where are we gonna go? It's a war. Maybe we have small children. Maybe somebody said to them, take a cow. And they said, okay, we have a cow, we'll like have milk, we'll survive, we'll just stay here. They became Soviets, then they became Russian. They got caught behind the Iron Curtain, which basically they became Russian citizens. Those people are now Russians. I was in Uzbekistan, and I interviewed this woman who was exactly like my father, who was a Jewish lady, girl at the time. She was 17, 16, 17. She came to Uzbekistan, but she didn't continue anywhere. And I said, why didn't you continue? And she said, I had no one in the world. My mom died on the transports. My sisters died when we got here. I was alone, and then I met a boy. And the boy was nice, and so his family accepted me, so I stayed. And she stayed in Uzbekistan, and her life was, I interviewed her in Samarkand. She was sitting in a place, she had like this sewage sort of, like just outside, and she was like, I said to her, how would you summarize your life? He said, it was a good life. It started out badly, but it wasn't bad. So the fact that in a way sort of our identity is so arbitrary, that my father became Israeli, but he could have been any one of these things, to me was very profound. This dude here, his mom is Polish, Jewish, and his father is Iranian. His mom stayed in Iran, and he was born in Iran, and he still lives in Iran. They have a shoe store, and in the basement of the shoe store, this is the basement, they have actually like a little archive of documents for these refugees. In 1942, the Soviet government was actually encouraging people, local people, to adopt children. This is to kind of, to show you patriotism by adopting refugee children. So this person, Uzbek person, adopted 10 children of different nationalities. And you see there are Koreans, and who were also exiled, and Jews, and Poles, and other people. To create a kind of blended family, so these kids became Uzbek. Okay, as I said, the Jewish children in Tehran were taken to a camp that was basically run by Jewish counselors. This is my father, right here. I was very happy to see that he's the one with the hair, because they all had lice, and he somehow was able to keep his hair, and he looks pretty neat. And they are evacuated eventually to Palestine. Now, as you can see, if you look at the map, the distance between Tehran and Tel Aviv is actually incredibly close. You can drive in about 48 hours. The problem was that in the middle was Iraq. And Iraq, now this is, Israel is not yet a country. But the Arab-Jewish conflict is already raging in Palestine. And Iraq says, we are not going to allow Jewish children to pass through us to get to Palestine. So you have even the Eleanor Roosevelt, who is the wife of the American president, writes to the Iranian prime minister. And she says to him, please, this is a humanitarian case. These are children. And he says, we're very sorry for them, but you know, we'll be happy to keep them in Iraq, but we're not going to let them go through to go to Palestine. So they end up having to go on a crazy, crazy route. They're going on British warships through the Gulf here, through the Indian Ocean, and then the Suez Canal, Egypt, and then to
Palestine. There are, this is all full of German sea mines, basically, and you have Japanese planes bombing. I mean, it's a crazy, crazy journey, but they make it.
And wait, let me show you. This is the day the children arrive in Palestine.
This is February 1943.
Now you have to remember that this is the middle of the war, right? The war goes from 1939 to 1945. This is 1943. They're the first group to come from there, from Europe, where the war is. These children are coming in rags and so on. People go nuts. The local Jewish population is going nuts. The children, the schools are closed. All the school children come out and are throwing candy at the children and screaming at them. And actually, the cover of my book, these are the local children looking at the children in the train. So this is like a very special day for the people who are there. In fact, when I interviewed sort of older Israelis, they always say, people remember this. They say, oh, I remember the day the Tehran children came and so on. This is my aunt, the girl that you saw in the beginning. Does she look happy?
No.
She looks very overwhelmed, right? So she, of course, the people outside are ecstatic, but the children, you know, they've been refugees for 3.5 years under terrible conditions without their parents. In fact, they left their parents in the war, right? So for them, and this is something that also took me a long time to understand, that for them, they were saved, but their parents were not saved. And they felt very guilty and very worried and continued to hoard food for their parents and so on. And they're eventually these children are eventually distributed between different families, collective settlements. Do people know what kibbutz is? It's kind of collective settlement. So this is my father in this kibbutz in 1944. There are some of the refugees didn't end up in Palestine. Some of them, as I said, went to Lebanon, to East Africa. Christian Polish children ended up in Palestine, in Catholic schools, in Jerusalem and in Nazareth, and going to all kinds of the university and so on. So the Middle East becomes a place where refugees find refuge. These are the contours of the story. And as I said, one of the things that has happened since this story came out, that a lot of people are finding themselves in the story. Either they went through this, or their parents went through this, and they were in Iran, and they were in Uzbekistan, and so on. And it's really amazing how much we need a story to understand our history. And when there is no story, then we think it's only our story and only our history. And so many people contact me with this point of saying, wow, it's the first time I understood that this is actually the fate of so many people. So, you know, it's been very nice to have written a book about, that is both very personal, but is also the story of so many people. So that's about it. These are the people, I'll just say these are the people who helped me. With my colleague, and this is a Polish historian. This dude here was my host in Russia. People always say that this is the favorite chapter in the book because it's a really funny chapter. This guy is basically a mini oligarch. He's kind of this wealthy Russian guy who has nothing to do with this story except that he is the father of my babysitter at the time. She was Russian, and she said, I'll go with you, and I'll help you, and I'll translate for you. So a day before we go, she says to me, actually, my passport is not, I realize that I can't, it's not valid, my Russian passport, so I can't go, but it's okay, you can be with my dad.
And that was something. So basically I land in Moscow and this guy picks me up, he doesn't speak any English. And he also, for him, he said, he didn't understand why this is important because he was also a son of deportees and he felt like, well, that's everybody's history. Everybody here was deported. So that was quite quite interesting, but in a way it was great because he was connected and wealthy. He could open a lot of doors for me that maybe regular academics can't. And this was my research assistant in Uzbekistan. As I said to you before, I had to pretend I was a regular tourist and he was helping me on the side. Now, Koreans were also exiled to Uzbekistan. So he was also a descendant of exiles. He was a Presbyterian minister, and therefore it was very dangerous for him to help me. I mean, that was actually either missionaries and was outlawed basically in Uzbekistan, but he was very, very committed to helping me find this information, and he did. So that's about it, and you know, I welcome questions. Thank you. Anybody planning to start a family memoir? Yeah.
Could you clarify, so when your parents started out, your grandparents started out in Poland, was the whole family sent to Siberia?
Yes.
And then the whole family was sent to Uzbekistan?
Yes, so the whole family, they flee as a family. The whole family is sent to Siberia, to Arkhangelsk. The whole family then continues on to Uzbekistan. They separate in Uzbekistan because they are evacuated with the Polish, what is called the Polish army in exile, and the adults are not allowed to evacuate with them. So yes, at that point they separate. And I was able to find out exactly where they separated because I located where they lived and everything. And so I kind of recreated that scene, and I mean, it was a very, very, very tragic scene, for sure. And they also didn't reunite they never saw their father again, because their father was ill with tuberculosis and he died. And they saw their mother only in 1949, so they actually ended up being separated for 7 years. Because what is now Israel was then Palestine under the control of the British, and the British were not allowing any of the adults in, so they couldn't be reunited with their parents. So when they met with their parents again, they were already adults, basically. They were in their 20s. They were the mother, I mean, that is. Yes?
What age was your father at the time?
So he's 12. He was 12 in 1939. He was born in 27. He was 12 in 1939. When he got to Israel, he was 15.
Okay.
Yeah.
You said that like when you were trying to gather like information in other countries, it was like, I don't know if it was like dangerous, but it was kind of like risky because there was like police and like normal clothing, and there was something you needed to watch out for because like they're watching you. Did you ever have any like close calls with the police?
Sometimes your ignorance is like your best tool, right? Because I was like, if I had Googled even Uzbekistan before I went, because it says, when I came back, I was Googling, it was like the third worst dictatorships in the world, you know, like they boil people. I mean, it's like, but I had once an encounter with soldiers in Tashkent, in Uzbekistan, when they ask for IDs, and everywhere you go, they take your passport, and then they're going to give it back to you. But I ended up, because I traveled as a regular tourist, and I also traveled, the travel agency that I traveled through was owned by the daughter of a government official, so I guess I was sort of protected. So I didn't really have it. In some ways, when you're a tourist and you're an American and you have an American passport, you're more protected than a local person who's doing it, than this guy, because I have the protection of, let's say, the American embassy.
Okay.
So I didn't have any close calls, but I certainly had some uncomfortable moments. In Poland, my host, and again, my ignorance was my best tool. I didn't really know who this host was, and she was a very conservative historian, and she was, I mean, we had some real clashes about the interpretation of history, let's put it that way. But
nothing really dangerous, and a lot of really interesting things happen. Because, you know, we think, we study history, and we think we live in the age of memory. Everybody knows, but it's not like that in other places. And you realize,
I was interviewed, in Russia. So as I told you, the policemen were there, and everybody knew who I was. And so on my last, I was there a week, somebody called me and said, the local radio station wants to interview you. You American. So I said, okay. So I come to this radio station, a young woman interviews me, and she says to me, so she interviews me, and then she says, what do you think about Stalin? Now, so Stalin, do anybody know who Stalin was? And I'm thinking, well, is this a trick question? What should I say? So I said, you know, in my story, Stalin was better, to be deported to these horrible settlements was better than to be deported to Treblinka, to be deported to a death camp, right? Because at least you had some chance of survival, even though many people died and it was horrible conditions. And she said to me, what's Treblinka? So she didn't know what that concentration camp was, and she was an educated person, but they never studied that, and they didn't study the Holocaust in high school, and so on. So the things that we sometimes assume, or sometimes we feel like, you know, it's drilled into us, we know so much about it, but a lot of people don't know anything, and they don't know anything about their own history of deportations. That was interesting, very interesting. Yeah.
Did you ever find out where your dad ate the outbreak?
Great question, fantastic question. So, I'm glad you asked, because I was going to talk about that, I forgot. So, so my brother is a physician also, and we now think, because when I was in Uzbekistan, I had many wonderful encounters, including, I found out where they were in this village, and there were these local Uzbek villagers who hosted me, and they said to me, our parents and grandparents tell us the story of these refugees, that they jump off the trains and they just ate, they were so starved, they ate live frogs. They chased dogs and killed them and ate them. So we they ate horrible stuff there, and we think he contracted it in Uzbekistan. We now know that it's a disease that can actually be dormant for 50 years. When we looked back, we started looking at my father's photos all the way back to when he was 15, and we saw that you can actually see that there are like slight neurological symptoms, like kind of tics and stuff like that, and we could all of a sudden we could see it. So we think it's Uzbekistan, and actually, a few days ago, there was an obituary in the New York Times famous human rights lawyer. And then I'm reading through it, and it says, he died from mad cow disease, and blah, 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 blah. And then it says, he was born to refugees in Uzbekistan, in Samarkand. And now again, because we don't have enough of this information, we don't have the list of the people who were there, it'd be very interesting to collect data and to see if there was really a large number of people who were there as refugees and ate that. But we know they ate horrible stuff, they must have eaten some infected brain there. I mean, it's not 100%, but that's what we think. There were only three cases like that, or four cases like that in Israel. Yeah.
So I'm about two-thirds of the way through the book. It's absolutely fascinating. And some of my students here, along with the students of Mr. Pritchin, we've just finished. So you had 10 years for your book. They had 2 weeks, right?
Oh my God! Yeah? 2 weeks before.
That was pretty
pages?
Impressive, right? 2 weeks.
I'm
yeah.
So impressed.
And so this has been they've been doing a lot of research, and it seems like research should just like be in a series of books. You open up the book, and there's the information, and you take it out. And it's not, especially because they were doing research projects about memory. And I wonder if you could speak to how research for you, I mean, it seems like your research was more of an art than it was a science. And it was this, as you said, there's this 10-year period, and you were constantly reflecting on that. And just the, I don't know, speaking to that and to the challenges and the level of creativity you had to come up with and to keep going when you had hit a dead end.
That's right. Yeah. Well, that's wonderful. I didn't know that you're actually teaching it. That's so great. And that's a long book. I mean, not a lot of people have even gotten through it at this point. It only came out 2 months ago. So that's wonderful. That's a great way to put it. I mean, look, I think I'm a literature professor, as we know, but I ended up writing a history book. At the same time, it's not exactly a history book. And this morning, so I'm actually at a conference here in San Diego, and this morning I heard a panel that was kind of on this, on packages that were sent to these refugees, and it was three historians, and I mean, God forgive me if there are like other historians here, but it was so boring. It was so boring. And I was just kind of like having a hard time keeping my eyes open, and I was thinking, wow, I'm really glad I didn't write it in that way. And I wrote a book that's more, in a way, personal. But I think research, to me, research is exactly, it is a very, it's not a scientific thing, because you get lost research and you get lost in the archives and then you find things that you don't think you'll find, and you don't find the things that you do think you'll find, and so on. So I think as a researcher, allowing yourself to get lost is really, like I said, when I said my ignorance was my best tool, to just go and see what you find was really part of this. You're absolutely right that it's an intellectual process, but also an emotional process. As I started telling you, I had a complicated relationship with my father. And my father was really, I mean, he didn't say anything. He didn't talk about anything. He was so reserved and closed off. And this was a kind of, it's as if I answered a psychological question in an historical manner, right? I mean, this question of who was my father, I researched for 10 years to understand him. And at the end, I do understand him better, and I am closer to him. At the same time, a lot of second generation memoirs of the Holocaust memoirs are very much about the person who is the second generation, right? And it's a lot of it is about, it's almost written, it's so overwhelming, it's so big, you almost, like, you don't want to know it. Who wants to know that their father went through horrible stuff and was victimized and so on? So it takes a lot, you have to work through psychological issues to get to the point where you can just be open to all of this. I researched, but everything is told from my perspective. So I get, for example, I told you about this Polish historian, right? So she reached out to me, and she heard I was working on this, she wrote me, and she invited me to Poland. And then when I came to Poland, she was saying to me, she hails from my father's hometown, and she said, oh, it's our town. She said, it's our town. And I said, our town? I've never even been there. I couldn't care less about this place. But she was like, no, Christians and Jews were great friends in Poland, and it's only because of the Germans and the Soviets who came in, they, you know, that it all broke down. And I was a little bit seduced by this narrative, because you want to believe it, right? You want to believe that there was some harmony, at least, and so on. But then you go into the archives, and you realize, I don't think so, because there are a lot of evidence to show to the contrary. So I describe kind of also going on the wrong path, thinking one thing and then realizing that it's another thing and so on. I mean, it's definitely a work of history, but also of memory. And at the same time, I was very committed to finding out the facts. I find that facts make things less overwhelming. I mean, it's not less painful, but it's less overwhelming. You understand exactly who was exiled, when, why, and so on. And it's helpful. And also you get to see a lot of different sides of the story. Also a lot of bright moments, you know, these bright moments where ordinary people just go to these children. And like I said, in Iran, when people, I mean, there was one scene where children said, people were throwing things at us, and we thought there was rocks. We thought they were throwing rocks at us. And then we opened it, and it was like these little parcels, like they would wrap candies in a handkerchief,
And, you know, and so, you know, there are moments like that that are very life-affirming. And there's also a lot of, let's say, aid packages, Jewish aid organizations in America and in England that are trying to help these people. So it's a story of bad and also of goodness to an extent. Yeah.
My father, both of my parents are survivors, and your story is really beautifully told here today. I haven't read the book, and I'm sorry I wasn't here for the beginning, but I'm really curious if you can reflect on what happened inside of you that compelled you to take on this project, to tell, you know, you may not have even known that you were telling your father's story when you began your journey, but can you tell us about if there was something in your life that triggered this?
That's an interesting question. I mean, I think, I don't know. I mean, I think, like I said, it really was triggered, as I said in the beginning, was triggered by a conversation with an Iranian colleague of mine who asked me about this. And in some ways, one of the things that really helped me is because these people were helping me. In a way, I was collaborating with a lot of people because you're working in these regions, you can't really do it on your own. And these people, none of them were Jewish. And Salar, for example, was really helpful. And one of the things that I describe is my relationships with these people along the journey. Now, when you're writing about Jewish history, you know, Jewish history is so, it's such a heavy burden, right? That you sometimes say, I would love somebody else to help me carry it, right? I mean, it's wonderful when somebody else helps me carry it, but those people have their own histories, right? I mean, so Salar was himself a child refugee because of the Islamic Revolution in Iran, and each one of them has their own story, and sometimes it's clashed, our story. So my story is not like we are the world, everybody's friends, great friends, and so on, but it does tell the story of collaboration, and that was very helpful to me. Other than that, I don't know, you know, it was a very gradual process. I was very resistant to it in the beginning because, again, it's so overwhelming. And, you know, I was born and raised in Israel. I was born, one of the ideas of Israel at the time was that this will be a country that will turn its back to Jewish history, to the Jewish past, that it'll raise people who will not be carrying this burden of Jewish suffering and being a minority and so on. And I was that person. So in some ways, I was sort of this kind of happy person who wasn't burdened by all of this. And at the same time, I was cut off from the past. And also, I was a little bit cut off like my father was cut off because you inherit those things, right? We inherit our parents' psychological makeup unconsciously. So this was really a process of really knowing so much and kind of reclaiming your past in a very, very big way, including pre-war past. I mean, the fact that my father lived for 8 generations in Poland, I was like, Poland didn't exist for me. Poland could have been a kind of mythical past. You know, I was just like, the first time I landed in Poland, this woman picked me up in the airport. She took me to her place, and I was like, God, like kids play Lego here, and you know, it's just a normal place because it was so mythic for me and so horribly mythic and so on. So, yeah, I mean, it's a kind of psychological, intellectual process that I try to convey that in the book. So the book is not just, again, about dry facts, but about a kind of journey. A literal journey, their journey, my journey, and an inner journey. Sure. Yeah.
You said that on your travels, not knowing about the governments that you were traveling, about the countries that you were traveling to, and what they did to the people was kind of a bliss. Would you say that in your past and as you grew up, not knowing about what happened, would you rather have known from the beginning and taught that as you have that? As you went along with this research, or would you
prefer to go? So did you hear the question? She asked me whether if I would have rather known my father's history as a child, or whatever, or was it actually a blessing not to know? And I mean, you know, when I think, a lot of times, even yesterday I was thinking about this. I was thinking, definitely for my father, I was thinking, well, how much less lonely would this man have been if he would have shared some of this, right? Because, I mean, he had nobody, he didn't really share it, not even with my mom. And I'm thinking, like, even on the level of this huge journey, right? And I'm thinking, wow, you know, he carried this burden and he just went on about his life. I think for him, it would have been much better to share. And I think the way, so you know how survivors today, a lot of times speak to high school students and so on. He never, that didn't exist because these people were not considered survivors. So they were not, they didn't go to speak to schools. They didn't commemorate. And one of the, one of the reasons I think that they were not considered survivors, even in their own eyes, is because there's a kind of economy of suffering, right? I mean, we know, because basically, when in 43, these children were the survivors and the pitiable ones. But in 45, when we learn about the death camps and so on, all of a sudden they're the lucky ones, right? I mean, it's very hard to call this lucky, but they are in fact lucky because they didn't die. And I think it must have been very strange to feel like you've gone through all the suffering and it's not recognized, and it's not, and you're lucky even though you lost everything. As far as I'm concerned, wow, that's a really good question, a really hard question, because there is a strength in turning you back to kind of creating something anew. Like you're going to be this new person, you're going to start, you know, you're not going to be burdened by this past. There is strength in that, but you, at the same time, you feel like something is wrong, right? I mean, you feel like certain, something's very repressed. So I would say probably, you know, it's good to know. I think it's good to know where you came from and what happened, even if it's very difficult and you can process it.
I think we'll pause right there.
Thank you for coming.